many challenges. But one of our plan was to actually have a series of lectures by distinguished scholars and friends of CUDS. And we are happy to Professor Tejaswini. I actually would request our chairperson, Dr. Kumar Sharma, to say a few words on CWDS and its journey. She was, as most of you or all of you know, that she was with the center from the beginning and was the director after Rosa Veena Majumdar for many years. And I really don't think we have anyone else to talk about the center and about its activities and the history than Dr. Kumar Sharma. So I request Dr. Kumar Sharma to actually, you know, share her thoughts. Before I request invite her to do that, I actually have a request to all the participants. I would request all of you to please mute your mics when the speakers are speaking. The lecture is live telecasted on YouTube. So if there are any technical problems with the Zoom account, please join our YouTube link, which is given in the invite.
There is some problem, Neeta, with your video.
So over to
Neeta. Can you hear me?
Okay. Yes.
There is some problem with your video.
I can hear you. You couldn't hear me.
Yeah, I can.
Is there any problem with my video? I don't
know. Yes.
It's okay. It's only with the video, no, not with the audio. I don't know. I'm using a CWDS laptop, so I'm not very familiar with it, whatever. But I think it's okay. If it is only video, it's okay. But I could hear, I was able to speak. No, the audio was clear. So, Kumud, can you please share?
Can I start?
Yes, please.
Okay. I think there are technical hitches and glitches. So I extend a very warm welcome to our guest speaker, Sivanti Niranjana, as well as all the participants. Since this is the first lecture in the Distinguished Lecture Series, which has been planned by CWDS to celebrate 40 years of CWDS, which is a milestone in the center's long history. CWDS was the first research institution outside the university system, which aimed at promoting and disseminating knowledge about women and mainstreaming women's concern within social sciences, teaching institutions, development policies, and planning. This was a beginning of a journey that was both challenging and rewarding, as CWDS explored the dynamics of gender roles within a diverse, plural, and hierarchical society, which was in transition. Establishing an autonomous research institution was seen as a prerequisite for exploring gender dimensions in all its complexities and generating new ideas for research and practice. Having a necessary blend of flexibility and strength to pursue its agenda was also seen as one of the important aspects. In a broad sense, the establishment of CWDS in 1980 was also an expression of the growing recognition of women's studies within academia. The debates which played out during the 80s provided the basis for developing its research concerns. 1980s also, if one remembers, was a period where there was a convergence between some sections of women's movement and women's studies. In its formative years, CWDS also laid emphasis on applied research, which was firmly anchored in the belief that research, particularly on women from the marginalized sections, has to be relevant for policy planning. Its action research project, which was in Bengal, gave CWDS a unique identity and got recognition both nationally and internationally by learning from the tribal women's perspective as to how they link the environmental issues with livelihood issues. CWDS has always combined research, policy advocacy, networking, and collaboration to transform gender relations and bring about changes which can contribute to women's equitable participation and build their capacities. Over the last 40 years, the center has grown into one of the premier research organizations in women's studies, expanding and enhancing ties between institutions, scholars in women's studies. Our research priorities articulated in the early 80s have been revised, expanded, modified, and built upon to explore appropriate methodology and develop analytical tools. It has moved into diverse areas of research and has expanded the scope of its work in areas like labor, gender and governance, political representations and women's marginalization, disability, violence, migration, demographic trends, sex ratio, etc. It has engaged with various disciplines and different ways of understanding gender as a social, cultural, and political process through which societies are organized. It has provided a forum for discussion and debates on emerging issues which affect women in various ways, and has collaborated with institutions across regions to feed fresh ideas into center's work. It is also founding members of Indian Association of Women's Studies, of organizations like FORCES, which is Forum for Christian Child Care Services, and is in many ways has really always tried to strengthen its networking. Its library is a very valuable resource to research scholars and students in women's studies, and is a repository of some of the rare documents which have been collected earlier, which may not be in the form of books and papers. So these valuable documents really provide a kind of a rich collection in our library. In the last 40 years, the world has changed dramatically and has thrown fresh challenges for research institutions. Complex problems beset us now in the spheres of economy, education, health systems, work areas, and new forms of gender equalities. The highly disruptive impact of current pandemic on people's lives, it calls for kind of a regrounding of frameworks of equality and social justice. We do need to develop fresh perspectives and conceptual frameworks for building organizations' capacities and strengths, and build a new partnership with other institutions, scholars, and organizations to enhance our outreach. I wish CWDS a joyous and a productive journey ahead, and hope that it continues to build upon knowledge gained in the past and takes the organization forward. Thank you.
Thank you. I hope we'll have a productive year ahead, years ahead. Okay, so let me now introduce our speaker, Professor Tejaswini Niranjana. She is in fact a very familiar scholar to most of us, and also a friend of CWDS. She was also associated with CWDS, and also the founder director, Professor Veena Majumdar. She has many accomplishments, which I'm sure most of you are familiar with, and I may require at least 15 minutes to actually go through those in detail. So to put in short, Professor Tejaswini is a very well-known and award-winning translator, a curator of multimedia projects, a documentary film producer, and a creative writer. She taught English literature at the University of Hyderabad between 1988 and 1998, and was the founder member and former director of the Center for the Study of Culture and Society, 1998 to 2014 in Bangalore, and where she has set up a PhD program, and that program is actually much sought after. She was held, she has held visiting positions at the University of Chicago, the University of Yonsei, South Korea, Cultural Studies, Chinese University of Hong Kong, and was a chair of the Center for the Study of Indian Languages in Higher Education at TIS. She's currently professor and head of the Department of Cultural Studies at Lingnan University in Hong Kong, and a visiting faculty at Ahmedabad University. Professor Tejaswini has published widely on several themes. She has written on translation, literature and cinema, feminism, gender and globalization, and more recently in the field of ethnomusicology. Her recent edited or co-edited volumes include Genealogies of the Asian Present, Situating Inter-Asia Cultural Studies, Breaking the Silo, Integrating Science Education in India, and most recently, Music, Modernity, and Publicness in India. She was the guest editor of a special issue of the Review of Women's Studies of the EPW on Feminism and Globalization. She is the author of Sitting Translation, History, Post-Structuralism, and the Colonial Context, 1992, Mobilizing India, Women and Migration, Women, Migration, and Music Between India and Trinidad, 2006, and the just published Musicophilia in Mumbai, Performing Subjects and the Metropolitan Unconsciousness, which was published by Tulika Books and Durham Duke University Press. We are very happy that you have readily agreed to be part of our distinguished lecture series, in spite of all the challenges and the restrictions that the current pandemic has put in. Before I request the speaker to start, I just have to say that Professor Tejaswini will speak for 40 to 50 minutes. After the lecture, we will have discussions. There are two ways to raise comments, questions. Either we can use the chat option. So please put your question, comments on the chat in the chat box as it goes. Or else after the lecture, you can raise your hand using the icon. And after that, we are requesting you to unmute and share your comments and questions. So we all look forward to your lecture, Professor Niranjana, please, over to you.
Thank you so much, Anita, for your generous introduction. Kumudji, thank you so much. It's an incredible pleasure. Maybe pleasure is too, inadequate a word. To look at the names here, should I be terrified, is more like it. There are people whose work I've admired for so many years. There are very dear old friends who I've not seen in a long time, and not just because of the pandemic. So I don't know, I'm really concerned that so many eminent scholars and many younger friends are here listening to me, and I'm not sure what I'm going to be saying. I mean, I do have some idea, but I hope it will meet your expectations. I'm going to really draw on the book that has just come out, which is called Musicophilia in Mumbai. And I've taken bits from the book and also tried to think afresh about some of the characters who feature in my book. Especially for this occasion. So I hope that you will enjoy that. So Performing Modernity, Women and Music in the 20th Century. It's a grand title, but I'm actually going to focus on Bombay City or Mumbai and talk about a particular time when three remarkable women that I will be discussing lived in Bombay. The idea of women performers in the 20th century public domain in India, whether they were singing or dancing or acting, gave rise to new discursive formations involving the law, aesthetics, and morality. The censorious gaze of colonial authorities denouncing the notch, for example, became distilled into nationalist austerities, such as the ban imposed on certain kinds of singing women by All India Radio after independence. As more and more women perform in public, the conditions under which they can be seen and heard and are allowed to live come to be constrained in new ways. It's a really complicated and multi-sided story. And I try to draw out some of the nuances by looking at the careers of a handful of women vocalists of the 20th century. Anjani Bai Malpekar, Gangubai Hangal, and Gangabai, who either lived in Mumbai or came there regularly to perform. The shaping of Hindustani Sangeet into a national music, the construction of musical taste in India before and after independence, the changing nature of livelihood and patronage, the transformation of how music was taught and to whom, the recasting of class, caste, and religious identities in identifying performers, the increasing significance of technology in reproducing the voice. These and other related issues have affected all musicians, whether male or female, but had specific kinds of impact on women performers and students. What were and still are the issues faced by women performers? How did they organize their everyday life to meet the economic and social challenges? What were the aesthetic and performative choices they had to make? How were these choices inflected by the nationalist discourse of the time? And what were the consequences of the choices for future generations of vocalists and for how Hindustani music is perceived today? I hope to touch on some of these in the course of my talk. Give me a second to share my screen and I will show you something. I can see that some of the people in the audience might be familiar with this image because we have seen this together before. This image is from an early 20th century postcard. And the woman on the right, in my understanding, is a Devadasi from Goa or a Kalavantin. The woman on the left is probably a Tawaife from Northern India. These were two kinds of female performers who were central to how Hindustani music flourished in one of the metropolises that became its home in the 20th century. So among the women migrants to Bombay in the late 19th century were these Devadasis and Tawaifs, the former from the theater repertories of Goa in Western India or from Northern Karnataka, and the latter from the courts of the diminishing Mughal Empire. I'll show you quickly what you've seen on the poster for my talk. This is done by my friend Jugal Modi, and he made this poster for an exhibition that I had curated, where he's turned these women around. And this, I think, gives you a sense of the present as well. These two women are now invisible in the history of music in Bombay or in the present day situation of music. They exist on the record, if you like. They exist through earphones that people listen to. They are turned away from each other now because they cannot recognize each other. And they're still joined at the hip, as you can see. So I think this is a very interesting image that brings that old story into the present, which I hope that my talk will also do. I will come to this picture, but before that I have a little preface, which is about the historical context in Bombay at the time. The fall of Awadh in 1857, during the British response to the so-called mutiny, signified the dismantling and dispersal of the princely courts of the Mughal Empire that had supported so many of the practitioners of Hindustani music. So after 1857, actually even before that, but 1857 is more of a symbolic marker, the singers, instrumentalists, and dancers began to migrate to other native states, big and small, seeking new kinds of patronage. Through the 19th century, as Bombay grew in importance as a major center of trade and commerce, connected to the hinterland as well as to overseas markets, it became a hub for musicians, both vocalists and instrumentalists, from different gayakis or musical styles, who came there to perform, to teach, and to record their music. So as I said, the dispersal process had begun much earlier than 1857, through the period of the gradual decline of the Mughal Empire from the mid-18th century onward, leading to the establishment of different styles of music in native states like Gwalior, Indore, Baroda, Jaipur, or Rampur, where leading musicians occupied the position of the Astan Gayak, or the court singer. princely states in the Bombay presidency also patronized musicians, with Baroda, Kolhapur, and Sangli being important centers, and smaller states like Jamkandi, Meerut, Ichel Karanji also offering a measure of support to Hindustani music. As historian Ian Copeland has pointed out, the strategy of indirect rule fashioned by the British Raj diminished the authority of the native princes, even as it gave them a seemingly separate cultural sphere in their darbar, where they held performances by singers, instrumentalists, and dancers. These performers were either permanently attached to the darbar or visited from time to time, as did Gauhar Jan or Fayaz Khan in Mysore. Eventually, the rise of urban commercial centers like Mumbai, providing many new opportunities for performance, learning, and recording, brought Hindustani musicians to the city. Many of them moved there for good, while others spent considerable time there during peak performance seasons like the Ganesh Utsav. The story of Kolkata, a comparable city, is somewhat different, but this has been written about by friends, my scholars such as Amlan Dasgupta, Adrian McNeil, and others. So today I have three stories for you about three women musicians. All three are from the first part of the 20th century. They're united also by location. They're from the native town in Bombay, which is called Girgaum. And the picture you see here is of a building in Girgaum. They all lived or stayed there at some point and sang there, okay? So let me talk about my first woman performer now. Her name is Gangabai. We have no picture of her. What I have instead is picture of the Mumbai Sangeet Kalakar Mandal. This is a kota in Girgaum, and it's very close to Kennedy Bridge. Opposite the Mumbai Sangeet Kalakar Mandal is the Congress House, which is the headquarters of the Congress in Bombay, and it still is called Congress House. This place is called NB Compound, as you can see there if you look very closely at the picture. So this was the home of Gangabai, who was a very important tawaif in the 40s and 50s in particular, but moved here very early on. She was from Moradabad. She was actually a Kumaoni, and she came to Bombay to continue her musical training with Kale Nazir Khan, whose family had migrated to Mumbai by the late 19th century. Gangabai's grandson is called Dayal Singh Thakur, but I'm not sure whether this reflects the caste lineage of his maternal family or not. The owners of NB Compound, which is located, as I said, opposite Congress House, gave the keys of the rooms, the entire compound really, to Gangabai, asking her to rent them out to any musicians who wanted them. As music critic Batu Diwanji describes her, Gangabai was a chaudhrani of the women singers, and every new singer who came to town had to present her with a nazar or gift. She was very prominent at the time in the 40s, and she hosted a number of very important singers, those who became important later. Two very famous Muslim singers who always stayed with Gangabai or lodged here at the NB compound, she was also called Ganga Bibi, were Bade Gulam Ali Khan, who initially played the sarangi in this kota to accompany the female singers, and Amir Khan. It's been remarked that not enough credit is given to the tawaifs for carrying forward, through their own learning and their support for practitioners, the musical lineages that found such welcome in Bombay. Tawaifs were often not acknowledged by the ustas as their real pupils because they were taught by bean players and sarangi players who'd assimilated the music of the great singers while accompanying them during their performances. Women's struggle for musical knowledge also includes the struggle for recognition and visibility within an established lineage as inheritor of a particular gayaki. This was especially difficult for the wives. So this photograph is showing you the center, which from about the 1930s until well into the 1960s, it is a major center of entertainment in the city, according to feminist scholar Geeta Thatra, who also points out the interesting co-development in that era of the actual Congress House building, which was purchased through collecting public funds, to which the wives also contributed. The Tilak Swaraj Fund of 1921, the Jinnah Fund of 1918, these were two important times when money was raised. So opposite the kota is today the Congress Restaurant. Its name alludes to the building next door. It was the office of the Indian National Congress from 1925 and through the freedom struggle. So this compound has rooms in which Deredartha wives hosted music and dance sessions. This included the Jume Ki Baithak on Friday afternoon post-prayer sessions. I will just come to that, sorry. In which veteran musicians in the Friday post-prayer sessions showcased their disciples and offered advice and criticism to the students of their colleagues. Sitar and tabla player Nayan Ghosh, son of musician Nikhil Ghosh, spoke to me of his father's visits with his guru to the compound and to Forest Road, which where other courtesans had their gotas. Nikhil Ghosh's guru, Amir Hussein Khan, lived at NB compound and was the chief of the musicians. So these courtesans not only offered financial support to the musicians they learned from, they also looked after young apprentice musicians. While the Jume Ki Baithak usually had khayal and dhrupad music, the time or the tem or mehfil in the evenings tended to have more semi-classical forms like the ghazal, the kawali, the dadra, and the tumri. These were performed by the tawaif, usually in a sitting position with the required ada and nazakat, using conventions of facial expression and hand movement that conveyed erotic longing. Today, the tawaif's descendants perform only the Hindi cinema-derived ghazals and tumris and are unfamiliar with the older repertoire. For musicians, both Hindu and Muslim, NB compound was a significant place on the circuit. Whether it's B.R. Devdhar, the musicologist, Pandarinath Mangeshkar, the tabla player, Naushad, the film music composer, or the several Muslim musicians I've already mentioned, Bade Ghulam Ali Khan, Amir Khan, tabla player Amir Hussein Khan, and many others who needed a place to stay in Mumbai. Under Gangabai's benevolence, the compound was a place providing tea, snacks, and musical conversation and exchange for everyone who came by. Frequent visitors included the film stars Raj Kapoor and Dilip Kumar, also Lata Mangeshkar, as I learned from Gangabai's grandson. In times of national or local crisis, Gangabai would offer to conduct a jalsa and collect money. She provided a good deal of financial assistance to the nationalist struggle also. So here's a woman musician concerned not just about her own livelihood, but also that of her community and also involved in national issues. At the age of 93, I am told, Gangabai used her Congress contacts to invite herself to a meeting with Indira Gandhi and present her with a check. Close by is Forest Road, and there the kotas like conducted by Punjab Jodhan, who was frequented by Hindi film music composers like Madan Mohan and Naushad, into whose tunes the ghazal, the khayal, and the tumri often entered. Madan Mohan and Shankar Jaikishan also visited this NB compound regularly. Although I had heard about it for so long and I've done this research over 10 years, it was only in 2017 that I was finally able to enter this compound. It was not a place where, you know, middle-class people often go. But that's another story and I won't go into that today. So one of Gangabai's tenants, as I mentioned, was a legendary Bade Ghulam Ali Khan, who played the sarangi first for the performers. And then he became close to Professor B.R. Devdhar, who ran the School of Indian Music, founded in 1925. And he began to spend most of his time in the nearby school. It's just 10 minutes walk from this compound. Often Devdhar and his students would walk with the Khan Sahib to Chowpatty Beach, talking about music all the way. Sometimes they came to NB compound to meet him or to meet Amir Khan. The option of going to a kota to visit the famous musicians who stayed there, however, was not available to the middle-class women who were also studying in Devdhar's classes or living in the neighborhood and taking taaleem from ustads who came to their house. One example is Lalit Rao, who's one of the people I interviewed, whose famous teacher was in Khadim Hussein Khan, who came to her house to teach. She lived very close by. She knew her sarangi and tabla players lived in the NB compound, but she could not afford to antagonize her community of Chitrapur Saraswats by going anywhere near the kota. So there we have the first story. I will now show you a picture of my second woman vocalist. Her name is Anjani Bai Malpekar. She was born in 1883 and passed away in 1974. She was a close friend of Gangabai from NB compound. She was a guru behen of Gangabai as well, because both had the same guru, Nazir Khan Sahib. She was born into a Kalavant family in Goa and was brought to Bombay at the age of 8 to begin learning Hindustani music from Ustad Nazir Khan of the Bendi Bazaar Gharana. At the age of 16, she had her debut performance at Muzaffarabad Hall near Grant Road. And I will show you as we proceed a picture of what remains of Muzaffarabad Hall. As legend had it, she received a fabulous gift of 5,000 rupees for her concert in 1899. She modeled for Ravi Varma paintings, including The Famous Lady in the Moonlight. She is known to have had bitter experiences of harassment in the courts of princes where she went to perform. And partly for that reason, she decided to stop performing publicly, which she did in 1923 at the age of 40, soon after the death of her guru. She taught many vocalists junior to her, including Kishori Amonkar, to whom she imparted the enchanting meend that was a hallmark of her style. Major vocalists like Begum Akhtar and Kumar Gandharva also obtained taleem for some time from Anjani Bai. She lived till the age of 91, engaging with music to the end. We don't know enough about how she managed financially. She had definitely earned well enough. During her time as a concert singer, she bought a house in Girgaon near Lakshmi Bagh, one of the most important performance venues until the 1980s. Her Gujarati businessman patron, Vasanji Ved, passed away when she was in her 40s, leaving a large number of debts, to honor which much of his property had to be sold. Perhaps teaching brought her some income, although it's always a delicate issue to seek fees from fellow musicians. In later life, while she continued to provide a space for music and musicians in her house, she started experimenting with creating a blend of Tumri and Khayal, saying she wanted to create something new. Anjani Bai was among the many Goan women who apprenticed themselves to Hindustani musicians in Bombay. They acquired patrons, and patronage means something quite different for women and men performers. They acquired patrons amongst the Gujarati merchants, especially the upwardly mobile bhatiyas, who often lived with the women and paid for their lessons from the ustad. Just three Khan brothers from Moradabad, for example, Nazir Khan, Chaju Khan, and Khadim Hussain Khan, not Lalit Rao's teacher, but another Khadim Hussain Khan, are said to have trained nearly 50 to 60 Goan singers. Ustad Aladia Khan of Jaipur trained Kesar Bai Kerkar and Mogu Bai Kurdikar, probably the best known of those with Kalavan backgrounds. Both also had Gujarati businessmen as patrons. In the stories that are told about these extraordinary women musicians, the patrons are only shadowy presences, as there must have been in the lives of those families, where when extended families met for festive occasions, one only saw women. Anjali Arondekar, a feminist scholar who writes about the Gomantak Maratha Samaj, talked at length about these all-women families of Kalavantins. Kesar Bai had hardly any students, but she did impart her knowledge to a Brahmin woman called Dhondutai Kulkarni, who had studied with the family of Kesar Bai's teacher, Aladia Khan, one of the earliest women of her caste, that is Dhondutai, to live by music, teaching, and performing. Dhondutai too had very few students, but one of them is Rutuja Lad, a rising star of the Jaipur Gharana, who you can listen to at the end in a film that I've co-produced, directed by Surabhi Sharma, called Fir Se Sam Pe Aana. This picture is probably more familiar to all of you, Gangubai Hangal. She was 93 years old. When I interviewed her in Hubli in 2006, we spoke in Kannada, but she often broke into Hindi while talking about things that happened outside Karnataka. She was also conversant with Marathi, as many people are in the North Karnataka region. And due to her great age when I spoke with her, she wasn't able to recollect many details about her taleem and only spoke about those things and events she had already found a language for and had spoken to journalists and writers who had interviewed her before. So I'll try to tell you a little bit of her story. Her first exposure to Hindustani music was through the records of Zorabai Agrewadi that she used to be played in Tamhankar's harmonium repair shop in Dharwad. As a little girl, says Gangubai, She would run to the shop on her way back from school to hear her favorite Zorabai song, Aan Baan Jiya Mein Lagi, and she started imitating what she heard. Gangubai's first teacher was her mother, Ambabai. Ambabai was trained in Carnatic vocal music by a Muslim teacher, Imam Sahib Harpanhalli, and a Hindu one, Shamachar. Ambabai specialized in the presentation of padams and javalis that were full of Shringar Rasa. Deepa Ganesh's biography of Gangubai has lengthy descriptions of how Ambabai treated her gurus, how she maintained a sparklingly clean house in a predominantly Brahmin locality in Dharwad, how she gave up cooking and eating meat when she married her Brahmin patron, how she looked after senior visiting musicians like Abdul Karim Khan and noted down their khayal bandishes to hand over to her daughter. It's a loving description of Ambabai and very rich in detail. But it interestingly doesn't make much of the fact that the women who were professional musicians, Ganewali as they were called even in Dharwad, ran their own households. They earned money through baithaks and concerts, with the patron or so-called husband visiting from time to time. In the next generation, Gangubai's managing of money is a story of terrible hardship. She had to look after her Brahmin patron's entire family since he wasn't very successful at earning a living and continued to care for them after he died. She also had her own large family with sons and daughter, uncles and aunts, cousins, nephews and nieces, and grandchildren. Without her musical abilities, Gangubai could not have taken on such huge economic responsibilities. Gangubai eventually obtained her talim from Ramchandra or Rambhav Kundgolkar, otherwise known as Savai Gandharva, student of Abdul Karim Khan. When she was 18 or 19 years old, she started going to study with Savai Gandharva. The talim took place approximately 8 days in the month, at least 2 hours per day. She used to take the train to Kundgol from Hubli, a short distance, and at 5 p.m. and come back on the 9 p.m. train. And often her maternal uncle used to go with her. Ambabai's ingenuity contributed crucially to Gangubai's training. Since Savai Gandharva was mostly in Mumbai in those days, staying at a friend's house and running his company, his theater company, Gangubai learned from him only when he was in his hometown. So to quote her, when my guru's theater company came to Hubli, my mother got our family friend Datto Pandesai to ensure that the rehearsals of the play was held in our house. Whenever my guru sang during the rehearsals, my clever mother used to identify the ragas, write down the notation, and teach me the compositions, which are all based on Hindi cheeses. Presumably the guru was singing in Marathi in these plays, but because these Sangeet Natak songs were all based on Hindi compositions, through learning these songs, Gangubai was familiarizing herself with the Hindustani ragas on which they were based. Her guru never told her the meaning of the words in the bandishes that he taught her. She had to figure out what they meant by herself. The Kannada-speaking singers like Mallikarjun Mansoor, Bhimsen Joshi, Kumar Gandharva, and Gangubai herself, for example, who became major names in 20th century Hindustani music, are likely to have had at some point their struggles with the linguistic aspects of the compositions. Most overcame it by gaining familiarity over time, not just with spoken Hindustani, but also Braj, Awadhi, and the dialects of music, as also with Marathi, which was either the mother tongue or the shared tongue of the growing audiences for Hindustani music. Gangubai had enough Hindustani to be able to sing, but there is some doubt as to how proficient her spoken Hindi was. But whether it was Gangubai from Karnataka or Anjani Bai from Goa, Hindustani Sangeet helped them to become more proficient in what I call the lingua musica, that allowed for a fluency in a language that could be sung, even if not spoken. For Gangubai, acquiring the knowledge of Hindustani music was a complex process, aided by her mother's sharp ear and quick hand. As I said, because of her Carnatic music training, Ambabai was very good at notation and used to notate everything that she heard. This was of huge help to Gangubai, who also depended on the Bhatkande volumes of the Hindustani Sangeet Paddhati for new bandishes and even ragas. From 1936 on, Gangubai started singing regularly on the radio and went frequently to Bombay for live broadcasts. Artists had to present 3 times per day, morning, afternoon, and night, with the ragas appropriate for the time of day. They were supposed to give All India Radio a list of 25 ragas from which a selection would be made, taking care to avoid repetition with what other musicians were singing. Of course, the Talim with Savai Gandharva was slow and intermittent, and Gangubai sometimes had to acquire a raga from what she calls bookish knowledge. But later, the lessons became more regular, and she started going to Kundgol every day for her Talim sessions. At odds with how the guru treated her was Gangubai's harassment by local boys on the long road from Kundgol station to Savai Gandharva's house. They shouted abuse at her, calling her Ganewali, throwing dirty water and other objects at her, even when she was accompanied by her maternal uncle, who went everywhere with her. She had to sit down on the stone bench outside the house for a while to compose herself and often wept. When Ambabai, Gangu's mother, performed at upper caste household events, they were full of appreciation for her musical talent. However, when lunchtime came, he had to wait for all the upper caste people to finish eating, clean up after them, and then eat whatever was remaining. In the search for musical and social respectability, Gangubai was often anxious about being put through the same humiliation. Although by the time she became known as a singer, such practices were on the wane. Perhaps it was Savai Gandharva's involvement in Mumbai's metropolitan music platforms, where he interacted with well-known singers with a Devadasi or Naikin ancestry, like Mogubai Kurdikar or Kesarbai Kherkar. Perhaps that's what made him accept a female disciple from a similar social background. Gangubai was one of the very few women from her region in her generation who became classical singers, and perhaps the only one to achieve the kind of national prominence she did. Although Gangubai's mother was a Carnatic vocalist, the interest in Hindustani music, as I said, came from Gangubai's own musicophilia, developed from listening to gramophone records. So the importance of technology in the learning of music, even in the early 20th century, is not to be underestimated. Perhaps because Gangubai was a woman vocalist of Hindustani music, which was a rarity at the time in her region, the discipleship to Savai Gandharva was one of musical apprenticeship only. It did not involve other kinds of service to a teacher that a male disciple like Bhimsen Joshi was expected to do, like carrying water over long distances, cleaning the house, etc. But those also gradually disappeared. I'm trying to describe the social context in great detail because I think the achievement of these wonderful musicians has to be really understood also in that larger context. Talking to Gangubai also made me realize how significant Mumbai was to any discussion of Hindustani music in modern times. She and fellow Dharwad musicians took the meter gauge train to Pune, changed to the broad gauge there to complete the journey to Mumbai. They went to Mumbai at least twice a month or more frequently and were able to sustain their households only with the higher concert fees. So they got 125 rupees in Mumbai as opposed to 25 rupees in Hubli. After she paid the sarangi and the tabla players 10 rupees each, that left 105 rupees for Gangubai to use both for her travel, her uncle's travel, and for what she could bring back to Hubli. She told me there were at least 12 art circles in Bombay in the 1930s, and they often had joint programs so they could share the cost of the travel. In Gangubai's story, the train is both central to her talim and an important mark of mobility. It takes her from Hubli to Kundgol for her music lessons. It takes her to Pune, where Savai Gandharva was staying for some time, and to Mumbai, where she recorded and broadcast her singing and gave concerts. The train also becomes her classroom on occasion, when she runs into a teacher on the train back from Bombay and who's upset with her performance of Rag Bibhas on the radio because she learned the raga from the books, and then sits her down in the compartment in front of the other passengers and tries to correct her mode of enunciation. Supplementing her lessons by dipping into Bhatkande's volumes, shifting constantly between a notationless mode of instruction to an autodidacticism where she reads the notated bandishes and teaches herself the raga, being constantly vigilant about the treatment she receives and what that might indicate about her place in society as a woman from a Devadasi family, using her professional stature to command public respect for herself and other musicians, which she did when she was, you know, heading the Lalit Kala Academy in Karnataka. All of these challenges reveal her talim as embedded in the social and circumstances and ancestry, that made her musical career thinkable, while at the same time constraining her choices in a number of ways. I'll now run through a few images on my PPT, because in the excitement of talking about the three women, I did not explain the physical context of Bombay. Here you see probably the kind of connoisseurs, the rasikas who would come and listen to people like Gangabai in NB compound, or Anjani Bai at her concerts, or Gangubai herself. This is a small place which looks like this inside, again in Girgaum in the native town, which was a major hub for visiting musicians. And all of those great singers you see there, and there are also a few women singers, have been performing there since 1907. And it's only now fallen into disuse for Trinity Club. Here is the place where Gujarati Sangeet Natak used to be held, Bhangwadi, and they used to sell bhang there. That's why it was called that, also in Girgaum. Here's the Royal Opera House, where Hirabai Barodekar, I will speak about her in a moment, has sung, and which, although it was hosting things like musical reviews from England, it also hosted Hindustani music concerts at the very edge of Girgaum. Here is Devdas School of Music, also very much in Girgaum, where Bade Ghulam Ali Khan spent a lot of time. Here's an ordinary high school, which the auditorium, which was very famous, and all of these singers I've been talking about have performed here. This is Lakshmi Bagh, and you will see more of this in a minute. Something that has been central to Hindustani music since the 1920s, well into the 1980s. Again, this used to be a place where plays and as well as concerts were held, and it now works for B and C grade movies. Here's another one, the Faramji Kamasji Institute, where also concerts were held as early as the 1870s and 1880s. These were the kinds of places the women lived in, the singers. Here's Haji Kasamwadi. Alaria Khan's family actually lived here, very close to the other music school. It's still a place where people live, as you can see. And one more such example of a chawl. So this establishes, I think, in some sense, what kind of physical space the people lived in. This still exists in Bombay, in Girgaum. This is my last image of such a place, a rather rundown place. Probably a lot of the wives used to live here. So let me come back to the last bit of my presentation now. I wanted to focus in this talk on the struggle of women musicians, three kinds of struggle. One, how to gain musical knowledge. I've talked about that. My three musicians were first taught by their mothers, and also by Muslim ustads or their disciples or by their accompanists. Without the mother's recognition of her daughter's talent, not a single one of these performers would have made a life in music. So the first struggle, how to gain musical knowledge. The other struggle, how to earn a living. They did that through concerts, through ghar baithaks, through singing for birthdays, weddings, and anniversaries, through teaching students, through having patrons. And they also wanted to raise money for public causes through music. Through jalsas, they had these benefit performances. A third struggle, also very, very important for the women I've been talking about. How does one maintain a public presence as a woman performer? And here I want you to think about the questions of respect and respectability. That there is a huge respect that the public has for the musical ability of the singer, but does that always translate into the respectability of the person? And how much of your life is actually public when your name has a suffix "bai" at the time? I think this indicates the ancestry of all of these people and where they came from. And this immediately places them within a particular social context where they may have respect for their abilities, but are not quite respectable. So when we look at the nationalist discourse about performing women, we see how the style of performance was affected. See, for example, the separation of voice and bodily movement that I'm sure all of you who have listened to any of the women performers notice. In the classicization of Indian music in the late 19th, early 20th centuries, voice and body become separated. I'm sure you've often wondered why women classical singers don't often wave their hands or pull in the notes or raise their arms. I mean, they have a few gestures, but not many. They have certain genteel movements when they're singing. Because the movement of hand and body belongs to a discredited past, and therefore for women did not belong in modern day khayal. Because this is what the women in the kotas used to do as they sang and danced, right? So the constant refrain one hears in musical pedagogy that people keep saying, you must sing in a female pitch, right? And people like me who don't have that pitch are always, you know, going through torture to tell the teacher, I cannot sing at that pitch. But this is a requirement also coming out of the requirements of an Indian femininity. The nationalist discourse also impacted the repertoire of performing women. Many of the singers we've discussed had a range that the range covered many classical as well as semi-classical styles like Tumri, Natya Sangeet, etc. But you'll notice that although some of the singers do perform these different genres, someone like Gangubai, for example, stopped performing across that range and decided to only sing khayal. She would never say when asked, why did you make that decision? She'd say, oh, I felt comfortable doing it. But what was that comfort about? Why was she not comfortable singing the other genres? It's something that we don't really have the answers to. This exhaustive study of how the repertoire got transformed has to be done by someone else. So I've spoken mainly about three women performers in Mumbai in relation to their struggle for musical knowledge, in relation to their publicness as performers and social actors, and in relation to the emerging new economy of music in the 20th century. In the city of Mumbai itself, there were a large number of other professional female musicians. Mogubai Kurdekar, I've already mentioned, Kesarbai Kerkar, Anjani Bai Lolekar, Baputara, interesting name, Baputara, who was called Bapu since she was like a father to her brood, although her real name was Tarabai Velinkar. There was Babli Bai, whose voice was held in awe by the great ustads. When they heard that she was going to be performing on a platform along with them, they would decide not to appear on that day. A powerful woman. Hirabai Barodekar, daughter of Abdul Karim Khan, the founder of the Kirana Gharana, who managed her own theater company and was a major concert performer, making frequent appearances at the Royal Opera House, the picture of which I showed you. To do justice to all of these stories, I would perhaps need more lives myself. So let me leave you with some music. This is by Rutuja Lad. She has been part of many collaborations of mine. I hope she's in the audience. I don't know if she is or not. She is the inheritor of Aladia Khan's Jaipur Gayaki via Kesarbai Kerkar and Dhondutai Kulkarni. She studied with Dhondutai for many years until Dhondutai passed away. And she is singing in our film, Phir Se Sampe Aana, directed by Surabhi Sharma. She's singing in a hall, singing in Lakshmi Bagh, next to Anjani Bai's house in Girgaon. CWDS Sundaresh, may we have the clip now, please? There's a sound check going on. So you will hear the sound through the headphones and then you will hear the woman sing.
Thank you for a very interesting lecture. I thought it was more than interesting, it was quite intriguing for me at least, because it raised so many issues which I don't know people like us, like me, I should say, who doesn't have much knowledge about music, was really feeling that it is something that it's of real interest to many, I'm sure. Anyway, so now we are opening for discussion, comments. I actually have seen few comments, which I'm sure you also have seen. You have replied to them. You want to start with those, or you want others to raise questions and then reply? You want me to read them? I can do it.
No, it's okay. Yeah, Neeta, I can read the questions, not a problem. But it would be nice if you took more, because I'm sure there'll be similar or related questions. So let me take a few more and I'll try to answer them together.
Okay. So can we have questions from the participants, audience? Please unmute your audio and then can ask questions.
So maybe I can begin with a round of comments.
Yeah.
So I just want to thank all the people, some friends who have raised these issues. Some of these questions I cannot answer. So I'll say what I can. I don't know much about Carnatic music. And Asha Ji has just asked this question about how to compare the two, and I'm afraid I can't. There are some very interesting writings on Subbulakshmi in particular. And there's also Amanda Weidman's very insightful book on Carnatic instrumental music, where she talks about whole questions of voice and so on. And I think that those might be places where one could look. T.M. Krishna's work on Subbulakshmi, for example. But I'm personally not competent to really talk about those differences. Asha also mentioned that she heard an earlier version in CCS, ISC, my God. So you can see how long I've been working on this material, a very long time. But thank you for being here and listening to the latest version of it. Thank you all the friends for your wonderful, comments and compliments. I'm really quite happy to see them. Quickly, I think there are two or three kinds of questions coming up. One to do with religious identity and the sort of the grayness in terms of defining caste, class, and religious identities. I think there are two or three questions that are addressing that issue. Let me see what I can say that might be different from what other people have said. Shubhangi comments that there is a religious pluralism and interfaith relationships among people like Ravi Shankar, Annapurna Devi, etc. Yes, I mean, in a descriptive way, you can see a lot of this everywhere. And I think that if you look at a place like Bombay or any other place where many of the musicians have come and interacted and passed on their knowledge and have, people have learned music, it's extremely difficult to say very clearly, especially now in hindsight, how do you distinguish, say, one mode of teaching from another or one mode of learning from another? People do come from very different backgrounds. There is clearly some, virtue in pointing out that there's clearly some value, in pointing out what are the very diverse strands of lineages that people came from in terms of especially religious background, but that tends to be often obscured in the present when it seems as though a whole new set of performers has taken over that either does not acknowledge the ancestry or has totally, as someone pointed out, Hinduized themselves and upper casted themselves also, right? But that's a description. And one can do that very, very detailed description. And I've done some of that in my book, most certainly. Other wonderful scholars have done it, including Anna Morcom, who's written at length about the Tawaifs and the ones who came to Bombay and so on. But I think I'm asking a slightly different set of questions. I'm trying to say that while yes, we need to know the detailed texture of people's daily lives and the where they came from and what they did, etc. What also did this mean for the musical culture that is developing in Bombay? How did this contribute to defining a different kind of public domain than what might have been found in, say, the Western world? So this was not a public domain that was, you know, say, for example, to use a very bad shortcut, Hamamasyan, but really a kind of domain in which the subjects who occupied that domain were social subjects, that they really became subjects through collective acts of listening, through being in performances, through being together. And I think that that musicophilia, as I call it, that developed in a place like Bombay, has a huge amount to do with precisely these women musicians, the vocalists that I talked about. The quality of voice, the evocation of voice, the kind of cultures they evoked, the performative cultures they evoked, whether it's in the Kota or in the, you know, in the today in the Mujra Hall, if you like, that's what it's become, on the concert stage, in the Ghar Baitak, wherever. We're talking about multiple locations that created these new audiences and that brought people together in a way that seemed to, for a moment, obscure the kind of differences of, you know, caste and class and religion that you might find. But of course, in a place like Bombay, while you had the musicophilia anchoring a newly emergent public domain, you could also see that there were certain strong tendencies in the nationalist movement and in the kind of social normativities that were developing in the early 20th century, where people privileged one form of singing, one kind of femininity, one that also then became associated with a particular religious tendency, if you like. So, but teachers were, you know, many and diverse. But, you know, like my concern with some, like say, earlier scholars who said that everything got Hinduized or everything got absorbed into a particular kind of devotional Hindu discourse. And this led to the complete obscuring of, what came before, or the teaching of the Muslim Ustads or the Tawaifs, etc. I think that for me, I would hesitate to use the word of, you know, all of that got obscured, or all of that disappeared, or all of that just got Hinduized. I hesitate because I feel that the performing repertoire, the performative repertoire, is huge and is extremely diverse. And no matter who sings it, even all the Brahmin women who sing today in Bombay and who are performed the other bulk of the women singers, someone was asking about that, right? Yes, of course, you can edit the repertoire. But at the same time, there's such deep sedimentation in those repertoires that you have to deal with it as you sing. They are being voiced. I think we need to pay attention to that voicing as well. And when we do that, I think that we will not, maybe be so quick to say that this is what happened. So I'm trying to challenge a certain story that's told, because even the critique is a normative kind of critique. And I'm trying to say that maybe there are other points of entry into that mode of thinking about women and music in a place like Mumbai. And to emphasize that it's so much part of their own modernity that they, like I said, you know, they really enter this urban space. They're struggling in so many ways through knowledge from the book, knowledge from the gramophone. It's not some, you know, ideal picture of some gurukul and someone sitting at someone's feet and learning music. It is far more complicated than that. And as kids, Gangubai even learns in the train in a second class compartment coming back from Bombay. So I think that the stories of these women, the lives of these women, bring to light these incredible complexities. So I think that's what I'd say for this moment. Someone was asking, Shraddha was asking about the caste class backgrounds of the famous women singers. I think I've already said enough about the three key women performers that I spoke about. Who, and many of them, I don't know if Shraddha was in the talk from the beginning, but I did talk about the two kinds of figures, the Tawaifs and the Devadasis, who were central to why Hindustani music even came to Bombay and who then disappeared, right? But of course, like I said, now, if you're looking at an entire history of the 20th century, by the time you come to the late 20th century, you hardly find any Muslim singers and you hardly find anyone who will acknowledge their Devadasi background. But clearly most of them have either married upwards and become socially respectable, But there also are those who are now, you know, Brahmin women who learn. Dondutai Kulkarni was one of the very early Brahmin women to learn. Until the 1920s or so, it was not considered respectable for upper class caste women to be learning this music. But after that, it became, you know, as when the radio became so easily available, when larger and larger audiences were carved out because of, you know, radio. And many ways, the radio also disembodies the voice, right? This just occurs to me now, that that disembodiment is then perfectly acceptable. If you're a Miss Suktankar, as the some of the singers who started singing then carried the name Miss, not by. That was no, there was a prefix and not a suffix. Yeah. So I think this is the story of how that changes in terms of their background. But again, if you dig deep, you'll find probably that maybe the background is not what it seems. So I hesitate to say anything more about that. I think I've sort of broadly touched on what's come about so far.
There's a question on gender performance and Sangeet Natak.
Yes. Actually, I don't. I would refer you to the brilliant work of Urmila Bhirdikar, my good friend, who has done an entire thesis, going to be a book on Bal Gandharva. And this is something that's a very well-known story, so I'm not going to talk about it. There are very good movies in Marathi with subtitles that you can watch, which tells you that particular story. But I do want to tell you something that I can bring to the table, which is that when I've been in Hong Kong for a few years now, and I've been conducting collaborative sort of interactions with Indian musicians and Chinese musicians. And I've been bringing Rutuja Lad every year to conduct some of these collaborative experiments. And 2 years ago, she worked with a Cantonese opera singer. In Cantonese opera, the male roles are played by women very often. And so this is someone, a woman playing a male role. And I had Rutuja dress up as Bal Gandharva, dressed like a woman, singing the Bal Gandharva songs. So I think there's a whole incredible story of cross-dressing and gender fluidity that emerges in the early 20th century, actually across Asia, and not only in India. And I think that's what has happened. I'm afraid some friends are entering at this point when we're nearly ready to wind up, including Samita. Maybe I should admit her. Okay. I'm glad they're all coming in, but it's nice that the participation list is growing while we are winding up.
So
go ahead, Nita.
There is a question about Nehruvian promotion of Hindustani music.
I'm just looking.
And the Congress House being next to Gangubai's house, how did that help? So,
the Congress House question. Let me.
Yeah, the Congress House question. And before that, there was a question about promotion of Hindustani music during the Nehruvian era, years.
Now this is a very fascinating question. Let me talk about this. Rita Mishra, how did partition affect relationships within the musical world? This is not, again, something I've studied because I have very limited canvas. I've looked at Bombay, but I can only offer like what I know from the Bombay situation. It did, I think, affect relationships. If you don't know the brilliant documentary by Yusuf Saeed, I strongly recommend you to look at that, which is a documentary about the Khayal in Pakistan. It's one of the most amazing films on music that I have seen. And I think that will give you a lot more information about what happened, how repertoires changed, how certain things got dropped, how certain things got reinvented, etc. So I can't say more than that. But I do know that Bade Ghulam Ali Khan, who was featured in my talk, decided to migrate to Pakistan and was so upset at how they were trying to, he said they were trying to police what he was singing, that he decided to come back. And he actually, I believe, asked Gangubai to use her Congress contacts to bring him back. So he owes her coming back to Bombay to Gangubai, who was one of the heroines in my story, right? So this was, Rita is asking, was that an enabler or a barrier, the Congress House, right? I mean, I don't think historically the Congress House or the NB compound decided to be opposite each other. They just happened to be opposite each other. But because Gangabai was so involved in the nationalist struggle, I believe they used to also pass, and many factions of the nationalist struggle, not just the Congress, they would pass secret messages, they would pass, you know, I think arms as well. I don't know, people talk in hushed tones about this when they talk about that time in the 1930s and 40s. So in a sense, they were doing the jalsas and raising money for many causes. And I think that there is a story, I'm not aware of the full details of this, but there seems to be a story when, I think this is there in Anish Pradhan's wonderful book on Bombay, music in Bombay before independence, where he talks about Gandhi was offered a purse by Tawaif and he turned it down. So that is one story, but I can't swear to it. I don't really know from my own research that that was the case. So I think maybe their contribution was limited to contributing money. But as I said, I heard that they were also involved in other kinds of activity. Before the Congress hegemony took over, there were many other forms of, I think, nationalist struggle going on, and they probably were part of that. But I think that, let's see, let me talk about another place. Next to Congress House is Jinnah House. Jinnah was a member of the Congress, as some of you might have forgotten. And Jinnah was someone who won a major case and raised money for the Congress. And the Jinnah Hall was built in his honor. It's still called Jinnah Hall. It was a very famous hall where concerts were held. Kumar Gandharva did one of his very early concerts as a young child in that. Hirabai Barodekar used to come there. All the major musicians used to come there. So there's Jinnah Hall, Congress House, and NB compound opposite. So it's a kind of place you find in the native town in Girgaum in Bombay. And it's a little difficult to isolate them from one another because they were all interacting in the same spaces. The same men who crossed the road, mostly men, to Jinnah Hall would cross the road back to go into NB compound, you know, after dusk to listen to the tawaifs and so on. So it's a particular time when these worlds were interpenetrating, except for, you know, the middle class women who could not enter some of these worlds. They were, of course, going to the concert hall, which they began to do after about the 1940s. I know there are too many questions and I'm not sure we have time to deal with all of them.
There's one question by Shashikant, where he is basically requesting you to talk a little more on lingua musica. And he wanted to know whether it was different for men and women singers.
Yeah, let me plug my book. I recommend that you read my book, Shashikant, which you should have got by now, since you follow musical works, Musicophilia in Mumbai, Tulika Books, please check on their website. In spite of the pandemic, they've been supplying copies to everyone I know. So please, there's a very elaborate discussion of that. And I would say, I'm just like, you know, putting my neck out, you know, like sticking my neck out here. I don't know if it mattered differently to men and women singers. Maybe not, right? Because I think that we can't look at that, the distinction, you know, like and say that the distinction is always there. Sometimes it's there, sometimes it's not. They were occupying the same musical space. They were having the same linguistic struggles. So it depends on, you know, where you come from and what... Someone has raised the hand, but Premi, but please wait until I try to deal with some of these questions on the chat.
There is a question actually about women singers' interactions with IPTA and other progressive cultural spaces.
I don't have much information about this. I do know that, you know, one of my teachers is Neela Bhagwat, who's a contemporary singer. I know that, you know, for example, I've gone with her and some other students to an old hall in Matunga, where Ipta used to have their performances. It's very known for that space. Also near Devdas Music School, across the road, across from Royal Opera House, there is a hall where Ipta used to conduct their rehearsals. This is what I know. But whether the musicians were also involved in them, I don't have that information, I'm sorry. So let me see. There is a question that's asked to me privately, but let me bring it up because I don't know if I have the competence. It's a very important question by Smita M. Patil. How do you look at the role of Tamasha and Jalsa performed by lower caste women at the same time, in that time, right? My late friend Sharmila Rege has written obviously an amazing piece of work that looks at Tamasha, Lavani and Jalsa and so on. The lower caste women who performed those, I'm not entirely sure about the linguistic and social background, but I imagine they were Marathi speaking and from various performing castes perhaps. But because my story is about Hindustani music and because I looked at how that has informed the public domain in Bombay, I looked at the lower caste women like the Tawaifs and the Naikins who came into Hindustani music. And I only looked at that form of music, but that's my limitation of my research. So I don't think, and I really recommend you, if you don't know Sharmila Rege's work, you should know it. So please, I think that you will find a lot more information than I can offer you in that work. Development of musical ideas in the period and how women contributed to that, I am not a musicologist. And I am not sure I can really talk about that. In my work, I look at the cultural and social context of music. I look at the kind of challenges women singers faced. I look at how the craze for music, the madness for music, enveloped an entire society. And so that's really the frame in which I'm looking at it. What are those issues around performance? I would not be a competent person to talk about musical ideas. I would recommend you to the work of maybe someone like Deepak Raja. He doesn't necessarily single out women who talked about musical ideas, but he does talk about some of the women singers and performers in his work. So that's the kind of musicology that talks about the development of musical ideas. I'm afraid I'm not that kind of scholar. There was a question of individual philanthropy by the artists. That's actually very interesting. And I think that the only example, a very visible example I have in my talk is Gangabai, who was extremely generous, extremely giving. She was not just providing free tea and snacks to everyone who came to NB compound in that time, but actually like many other Tawaifs, were supporting a bunch of young musicians. I don't think it was so hard and fast, like who was family, who was not, who belonged, who did not belong. If you were there and someone was eating, then you also ate, you know? So I think that the idea of patronage of art, which is, I've talked a little bit in my book because it's the my interviews with Nayan Ghosh and so on that I've drawn upon, the Tawaifs did in the early 20th century support a very large number of performers, either directly or just indirectly in different ways, but providing them a space to perform by looking after their nutrition, by making sure that they got opportunities to perform and so on. So there are multiple ways by which you can patronize art, and I think the women did all of that. Yeah, there's my colleague in the Asia Art Archive in Hong Kong, Ozge Ersoy. Lovely to see you here, Ozge, who's given you the details, and you have the video performance here of Rutuja Lad pretending to be Bal Gandharva, pretending to be a woman. So please take a look at the chat box and please do click on this. I hope you enjoy the video. Let me quickly see if there's anything else that I can cover in the next few minutes.
There is a question about dress code, which has come from the YouTube watchers.
Whoops. Can you read it out to me, Nita, please?
Yeah, it says that, can you please tell us about the dress code during performances?
I have no information about that. It's just my own observation over the last 20 years in Mumbai and elsewhere in the Hindustani music circuit. And those observations will be the same as yours. So I don't think I need to comment on that, right? I was more interested, let me tell you a story that you may not know, which Gangubai told me, Gangubai Hangal. She said in her old age, like I said, she kept on repeating herself, but she was very much like devoted to her daughter who died of cancer at, long before Gangubai passed away. And Krishna Hangal and Gangubai used to perform together. They used to travel together. And Gangubai said very proudly that Krishna had kept a book where she wrote down what sari they wore at which performance, so they could make sure not to repeat their saris, right? And this was clearly a huge advance for Gangubai, because when she was younger and she was extremely poor, people would laugh at her for her clothes and for her appearance. And she was totally humiliated by that. So you can see that maybe after she had little money, she could afford to buy more saris. I think you don't find much difference in the way Hindustani women singers comport themselves, how they sit, what they do, the sindoor, the Mangalsutra prominently displayed, if possible, the pallu, etc. But I think if you look at the younger performers, for example, someone like Rutuja, you will not find the same aesthetic. It's an interesting question. Maybe I will think about it some more, but I've only glimpsed it. I haven't really, thought about it a great deal. So maybe next time we meet, I'll have some more insights into what semiotically that might actually signify, like in terms of the changing appearance and dress code of women performers. Thank you for the question, though.
I think we don't have any more questions. We have covered.
There's one new message. Can I just see? Oh, Meena. Hi, Meena Gopal. Okay. She's thanked me for my presentation. It's so nice to see so many people I know here. So someone's asking how to reach out to me. Please Google me. You will find my email. You can look at the Lingnan University website and you will find my email. Feel free to write. Aparna Roy had asked a very interesting question about the idea of voice and body and gestures and the parallels in the bazaar paintings. But this is something I haven't thought about. Yeah, that's very interesting, actually. I should look more carefully at those paintings. Thank you for bringing that to my attention. I think I am sort of done. I'm so glad that Shubhangi, who is a Girgaon native, is here. That was so... Shubhangi, I should interview you sometime. I need more stories. Please reach out to me. Okay. Yes, I am done, I think, Neeta.
No, there is a
How
question.
About yourselves? How about CWS people? CWS people, do you have any questions?
No, just now there is a question that has come about use of technology in current Hindustani learning.
Let me just check. Okay. Changing use of technology in current Hindustani learning. This actually, Uma, again, old friend, please, I hope you've got my book, please read. Maybe you're asking just a helpful question, but so thank you for it. I hope she's read my book. Basically, I've been completely superseded here because when I started learning on Skype, because I used to travel a lot, and although I had a teacher either in Bombay or in Bangalore, I had this young teacher in Bangalore who said, okay, let's try Skype. And in 2011, quite a long time ago, I started learning on Skype. The platform still did not have too many people, so it was possible to have a reasonable class with all the breakups and breakdowns because of bad internet generally in India and in other parts of the world. So that happens, the breakdown and the constant breakdown becomes part of the learning process. So it really changes the way in which one thinks about the musical transmission, I think. Then people are now using WhatsApp video. People are using Zoom, of course, after Zoom came into our lives so dramatically a few months ago. Now everyone's on Zoom. So in a sense, I mean, I don't know if Uma's question is about what's the meaning of these changing technologies, in which case I am still thinking about it. But I've just given you a list of technologies that are being used. I think that distance learning, as we are many of us who are teachers are suffering from this at the moment. I thought I would find it easy because I've been studying music for so long in a distance mode. But I think the learnings didn't really transmit. Because what is so important to musical learning is face-to-face learning, whether it's online or otherwise. And in the kind of class that I teach mostly undergrads in Hong Kong, either by choice or by necessity or because of necessity, people don't show their face or say anything. So I'm lecturing to completely blank screens. And that is not the way that, Hindustani music can be taught, for example. So Uma, we can continue this conversation offsite. But I wasn't completely sure what was the scope of the question. So I'll just stop for now. Oh, she says she just got my book. Okay. Please do get back to me when you read the extensive section on Skype and distance learning. I've talked about, just to give you an idea, I talked about a new kind of intimacy that forms between teacher and student when we are face-to-face, so close, rather than sitting respectfully apart in the room when you're learning offline. I call it Skype-timacy. But now that Zoom has entered our lives, I have to think of another name.
Okay, I think we are through with the chat box comments.
Yeah.
Any more comments from the floor or the participants who are there? Please unmute and ask. I think we are done, looks like.
Can I just say a word of thanks to this wonderful audience? They're really stimulating questions, and I'm so honored that so many important senior scholars are here as well. Thank you all for coming. And do reach out to me if you have any other questions or you just want to tell me what you thought.
So I think I thank
you. Thank you so much to Kumuji, to Neeta and Mary for thinking of inviting me. I know that the kind of work I do is not center stage in a place like CWDS, although I've interacted with CWDS for so long. So it's all the more meaningful to me that you chose to have someone like me to inaugurate this lecture series. Thank you again. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for giving us a great start for our 40-year distinguished lecture series. So thank you. And let me also thank all the participants and also the chairperson for and all those senior people who are there, who are part of our EC and also extended family. Everyone is there. So I would like to thank everyone. And we also look forward to your participation in the lectures that will be part of the series that will be coming up every month now. And also Mary for coordinating this lecture with you. And thank you. Thank you all. So see you all for the next lecture now. Thank you.
Thanks, Teju.
Bye.